I'm here to introduce, since we started our wonderful distinguished lecturer series, I think every year I've asked Maude if she could possibly come. And it's been her schedule. I have to say, you guys know I work hard. Maude Barlow is the only person I know who works harder than I do. Well, or at least as hard. We agreed over dinner. We work as hard as each other. And Maude is tireless, except for those of us who are tireless know that we're often tired. However, we're usually introduced as tireless. It means we work when we're tired. and Maude has been for 28 years the national chairperson for Council of Canadians, which is a volunteer position. I first met Maude when I was at Sierra Club, but before either of us were in the NGO world, and this is one of my favorite, it's just a typical Maude story, it was wonderful. She was at one point in the Prime Minister's office of Pierre Elliott Trudeau, in charge of women's issues. And she was sent forward to an event to represent the Prime Minister. And the introduction said, now Maude Barlow is in charge of women's affairs for the Prime Minister. And she said, actually, I'm in charge of women's issues. He handles his own affairs. And the people in PMO had to say, don't do that again, really. Not really funny, Maude. But that's Maude, of Maude's 18 books. Maude, 18 books? See, I have a measly 8 books to my credit. But one of my favorites is the one that Maude and I wrote together, which is the story of the Sydney Tarpons, and it's called Frederick Street, Life and Death on Canada's Love Canal. And Maude and I wrote that book together and did it through tears. We were literally weeping. We'd interview people, we'd go off and cry, and she'd write a chapter, and I'd write a chapter, and then we'd compare notes. So I'm not going to take any more time away from what you're here tonight to hear from one of Canada's authentic national heroes, someone who is consistently selfless, brave, speaking truth to power, writing truth to power, and right now a global champion for the basic principle that water is a human right and water is sacred. Please join me in giving a huge shout out to Maude Barlow.
Thank you, Adam. Thank you, Dave. A big shout out to the Council of Canadians local chapter here. Thank you all, especially on a rainy Sunday night. I thought, I said, Elizabeth, nobody's going to come. And thank you for that introduction. I do not compare myself in any way, but I once read that Winston Churchill, after a very moving introduction, said he could hardly wait to hear what he had to say. Obviously, good introduction should come later, you know. She wasn't that good. I don't know. Delighted to be here. Delighted to be in your stomping grounds, Elizabeth. And yes, we had that book about, we were reminiscing over dinner about the Sydney Tarpons, which is what was the 100 years of steel making in Sydney, Nova Scotia. And when Elizabeth said you have to come and see it, it's like a moonscape and you won't believe it. And there was no way to describe, to believe what we saw until you took me there. I mean, we wrote about this man who got up one night in the middle of the night to get a glass of water in his kitchen, and he knew the kitchen so well he didn't have to turn on the light and opened the door to let the dog in. And they were playing out in the tarpon, so the dog came in and glowed in the dark. Do you remember that? And I was reminding Elizabeth my favorite story. There was a union organizer named Dan Yakimchuk, and he started the first union at the Sydney Tarpons at the steel mill. And they were really opposed to it, and they got the priest to come around and tell him this wasn't a good thing. And he said with this very heavy accent from the area, he said, you know, now the priest comes by and he says, now, Danny boy, you got to stop this now. You got to stop this union stuff. You're going to go to hell. And he says, I says to him, Father, the problem with hell is you can't enjoy the fire for all the goddamn priests hanging around in the bushes. Get out of my house. True story. right here to talk about my favorite topic, and that is the way we think we love water in Canada. It's filled, our history is filled with it, our literature, our music is filled with it, but the truth is that if you look really closely, we don't take very good care of it at all. It was something that I experienced over the last 20 years of working on the human right to water around the world, and I've been to communities and poor communities and slums all over the world, and I've seen what life it looks like when people don't have enough water to drink, and or their children have only dirty water to drink. But I would come home, and people here would be sympathetic, but it would be like it's a problem far away. It has nothing to do with us. And it is true that there is a global crisis out there, a very serious global crisis. In fact, the United Nations says that by 2030, the demand for water in our world is going to outstrip supply by 40%. And just try to stop for a minute and try to get an understanding of what this could possibly mean, that the supply, that we will only have about 60% of the water that we need within the next decade plus. And so we have, as a species, we've polluted, we've diverted, we've mismanaged water, we've assumed that it was a resource for our pleasure and our profit, and we've used it in ways that have been horribly damaging. In fact, a very important international study found that we're doubling the taking of groundwater every 20 years, and this study said that if we're pumping the Great Lakes of North America as mercilessly as we are pumping groundwater around the world, and I quote, the Great Lakes could be bone dry in 80 years. Pretty stunning, a pretty stunning statement. So my journey on this book and the work that I've been doing recently is to tell Canadians that we, in fact, are not immune to the issues that are happening out in the world. And in fact, even the whole issue of the human right to water, we have thought certainly in the so-called first world, that this was a problem of the global south. But when you have rising poverty rates and rising water prices and declining water stocks, we're beginning to see the human right to water denied to people in the so-called first world. With the austerity measures in Europe, they have been cutting off the water to thousands of people. And in inner cities through the United States, there are hundreds of thousands of people who've had their water cut off. Detroit is the city I know best because I've done a lot of work there. It was an outreach or an outgrowth of the NAFTA loss of jobs, and a lot of people moved out, about 1 million people moved out of the city. They left behind inner city, largely African-American, poor people without jobs, so there wasn't enough of a tax base to continue to have reasonable water rates, and so they jacked the price of water up, and when people couldn't pay, they started moving in and just shutting off the water systems. They've shut off water to about 50 to 60,000 people now in Detroit. And you can't imagine, you're talking about a situation where you've no water for cooking, for toilets, for bathing, for anything. You have old people, you have kids, you have small kids, the social security comes in and take, or social workers come in and take your children away because you're not allowed to be raising children in a house without running water. So I want us to understand here in the so-called first world, particularly here in Canada, that the issues that exist out in the world exist here. And I want to talk a little bit about what I know as the situation that we need to be looking at. First of all, we do not have 20% of the world's fresh water. That's something that was on the Environment Canada website till about a few years ago. We finally talked them into taking it off. We have about 6.5% of the available water. That's the water you can use without taking down the stock. And actually, for the 90% of us who live in the southern part of the country, even that's not quite true because we have about 2.8%. And most of that water is in mighty rivers flowing north. The water yield, what they call the water yield, is declining every year quite dramatically. There's some fairly new statistics out of Environment Canada that tell us that we are actually in crisis in a number of places in Canada. Climate change is warming our lakes, all of them. The lakes around the world, of course, are warming, but a recent global study said Canadian lakes are warming the worst, the fastest, and the fastest of those is, if you can believe it, Lake Superior. Our glaciers, all of them, are melting. Our Arctic lakes are disappearing as the permafrost melts. First of all, it looks like there's a lot more water, but then, of course, there's lots less. Our groundwater has not been properly mapped, and we have very little protection for groundwater in Canada. It's quite stunning. And thank you to the Shawnigan Lake fighters, because it's, I write about your struggle in the book, because you know that's one example of just hundreds around the country where we have not protected our groundwater. In fact, in the United States, there are legal injection sites to put to dump toxics into groundwater. And I think of this engineer who was the first person to have a cup of ancient aquifer water that was found in an aquifer just under Mexico City not long ago. And when he pulled it up, because they were running out of water in Mexico City, he took a sip of this water and he said, "This is why you don't destroy your groundwater. This is why you take care of your groundwater, because one day you're going to need it, right?" So our groundwater is not protected. We do not have national drinking water standards, and our wastewater standards for humans most of our public taps have clean water coming out of them, water that's tested, but the standards are not even across the country. And we have absolutely no standards whatsoever for animal waste, which is a huge issue. Our forests and our wetlands are being razed very quickly, and we know these are the ways in which we protect our water. And we're destroying our wetlands. About 70% of in settled areas are gone. We dump 150 billion liters of untreated or undertreated sewage into our lakes and rivers every year. And untold toxics as well. Toxicity data are missing for 87% of all chemicals sold in the Canadian market. We just simply don't do the testing, and we don't know. We do not apply the precautionary principle. Every year we pour more than 35 million kilograms of herbicides and pesticides onto agricultural lands. And Canada allows chemicals and pesticides such as glyphosate, which is a Roundup Ready herbicide, and their hormone disruptor atrazine, not allowed in many other countries. And in fact, this is one of our chief arguments against the CETA, the Comprehensive Economic and Trade Agreement with Europe, that we've been making when we're in Europe, saying we have much lower standards. And we actually put out a report at the council showing how over the last 20 years we have changed our standards, lowered our standards in the way we grow food and the way we produce agriculture, more cheaper food for export, more factory farms and so on, as a result of harmonizing under NAFTA. So our statement to our friends in Europe is, if you think that you're worried about an agreement with the United States, you should be equally worried about Canada, because we have much lower standards than you do. Microcystins, the potentially fatal toxics found in blue-green algae, have been found in a recent study in 246 lakes in Canada. And eutrophication is, in some people's estimation, killing Lake Winnipeg, certainly threatening Lake Erie, all back. And on First Nations, with all of the work that we're trying collectively to do, we're not doing well yet at all. Two-thirds of all First Nations have been under a drinking water advisory in the last decade. So we're starting off with some very bad news. Then the question is, and the book is actually called Government Neglect, Corporate Abuse, and Canada's Water Crisis. We have a crisis. What is our government doing about it? Well, our laws are a patchwork of uneven and often inadequate regulation and standards very desperately in need of strong federal government leadership. We never fully implemented the last national act we have. It's from 1970, which is pretty pathetic. Budgets for Environment Canada, particularly water protection, have been starved from the beginning. They fell deep victims to the Paul Martin cuts of 1997. One federal government scientist at the time predicted a Walkerton-type tragedy, but couldn't pinpoint the place, but said later, "I knew it was going to come." But nobody has assaulted our water laws like the Harper government, absolutely no one. First of all, they brought in loopholes to the Fisheries Act that allowed mining companies to have a lake redesignated, not a lake, but a toxic impoundment area, so that it's no longer a living lake and no longer protected by the Fisheries Act. And then they gutted the Fisheries Act, and they gutted the Navigable Waters Protection Act, and they gutted the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act. And with these changes, protections for 99% of all of the lakes and rivers in Canada are gone. Pipelines carrying what Elizabeth was talking about, diluted bitumen, carrying explosive gas, loaded with chemicals, can now pass over, under, or around more than 31,000 lakes and 2.25 million rivers without any federal scrutiny whatsoever. The Harper government also waged war on science and scientists. 2,000 scientists, many of them involved in water research, were fired. And hundreds of research projects, facilities, and institutes were either closed or slashed, including the Experimental Lakes area, which got rescued by Ontario and Manitoba. The Canada Centre for Inland Waters, which did incredible work on the Great Lakes, and the Global Environmental Monitoring Water Program, which did monitoring of lakes around the world for the UN, didn't cost very much and was shut down by the Harper government. They cut, made huge cuts to Environment Canada, to Fisheries and Oceans, to Parks Canada, and the number of inspections for violations and lack of enforcement fell off a cliff, according to one scientist. In fact, the head of the Department of the Enforcement Branch, charged with implementing the Canadian Environmental Protection Act, retired last January. He put out a statement saying, "There's nobody minding the store. We are actually breaking the law. We are not enforcing the Canadian Environmental Protection Act. We're just glossing over, the violations of this act." This is, at that point, it was for fear of being aligned with the Harper government's priorities toward industry, but also because we simply don't have the personnel anymore. Said another senior scientist, "In 31 years on the job, never have I witnessed such systemic destruction of the scientific capacity of the federal public service. Science has been cut to the bone. There is no way to cut it further without just stopping." So this is where we found ourselves when the Trudeau government came to power. Then as well, we have growing and increased violations of the environment, and particularly of water, from the fact that we're now more reliant than ever on our natural resources. 30 years ago, GDP, manufacturing represented about 26% of our GDP. Now it's down to 11%. So we are turning back to the exploitation of our natural resources for export, and that has a very disastrous result on our waterways. There's been a dramatic increase in oil exports in the last decade, much of it, of course, from the tar sands. And as you probably know, current operations remove a volume of water from the Athabasca River that is more than twice the amount of water that's used by Calgary every year. Three quarters of the river's declining water stock is affected. 95% of that water is too polluted to return to the river, and so it's held in huge toxic dams. They call them ponds, but if you've ever stood there and looked at them, they don't look like ponds. And they leach over 11 million liters of toxic water every day into the surrounding water systems. Canada's water is also at risk from the proposed pipelines, the bitumen diluted with chemicals such as benzene. We've been fighting, and where I come from, Energy East, very hard. Energy East, the Energy East pipeline would cross almost 3,000 waterways on its voyage across the country, including under the St. Lawrence River. And it would put the drinking water at risk of almost 5 million people. We're waiting in December to hear the news about whether the Trudeau government is going to say yes to Kinder Morgan. Again, dozens of waterways, including the critical Salmon Bear and Fraser River, five provincial parks, and Jasper. I mean, it's just an absolute travesty that this could be conceived of. But I have to tell you, if you ask me today what I think is going to happen, I think that they're going to say yes to Kinder Morgan. Who knows if they aren't going to say yes to Energy East as well. It's interesting if you see the reaction to the fact that because Donald Trump has won in the U.S. and it's likely Keystone is going to be revised, you could have thought that the Trudeau government would say, you know, that's passed off to another jurisdiction, but they're giving a very strong signals. No, they passed the day when they were counting on this energy going south. They want to diversify. They want to get this energy to Asia. And it seems clear from a number of reports that have come forward from the Chinese government that they would consider a trade agreement with Canada only if they get this at least one pipeline to bring this energy to water. And make no mistake, these pipelines spill. In Alberta alone, there's been an average of 2 spills per day for the last 3 decades. The Great Lakes is becoming a carbon corridor, carrying bitumen by rail and pipeline, some onto the Great Lakes, and now increasingly on barges on the lakes. The U.S. Coast Guard recently said yes to barging fracked wastewater from fracking on waterways, on barges, on waterways in the United States, which is just an insanity. And of course, we all have the new reality of the new government that's going to be formed in the United States, and we know what they think of the environment and what they're going to do to the environment. We're also very concerned, or I'm concerned, about how fracking consumes and poisons between 8 and 32 million liters per well, with hundreds of chemicals, many of them carcinogenic, leaving a groundwater legacy that's very serious. In Alberta and BC alone, there have been 40,000 new frack wells in the last decade, and at least as many are planned for the next, and massive volumes of water are contaminated as a result. Mining is on the rise right across the country, particularly in the northern areas, and again, it's just like a free-for-all. I mean, when you take a look at what's allowed and how people get licenses and how you can open up a mine and to whom you are responsible, no one. I mean, it's absolutely nobody watching your store. And many lakes are being killed with the toxic runoff from the way we grow food, or export-oriented, corporate-dominated, chemical-reliant factory farms, where we have some of the lowest standards for animal welfare in the entire world, and the sewage runs off into our waterways right across the country. Then we have land and water grabs, which is one of the newer kinds of threats to water and to our rural communities that are happening. It's happening in Alberta, it's happening in Saskatchewan, it's happening right here in British Columbia, where you'll get investors from Toronto or New York or wherever coming up to the farm gate and saying, I know it's expensive to run your farm, we'll buy the farm from you and you can continue to run the farm, you'll be a tenant farmer. We think of that as being far away, but it's happening here in Canada. We also have many other forms of water threats and water privatizations. We have privatization of municipal services. Again, this was a Harper project where if you were going to put new money into infrastructure or upgrading infrastructure and wanted federal funding, you had to move to a public-private partnership. So we have a number of municipalities in Canada that have gone private or are going private. The Trudeau government has backed off that. They've said that's not going to be a condition of getting federal funding, but at the same time, they're saying they support public-private partnerships, so we'll see where that goes. We have water trading, which started in Alberta, started in many other countries. I go into some detail about the project in Australia where they converted the water permits and water licenses to water property. And allow people to buy, sell, and trade water, and the price of water went up so drastically, so immediately, that when the new government a few years later came in, tried to buy back water for the Murray-Darling River, they couldn't afford to do it. So the first province in Canada that's brought in water trading is Alberta, with very serious repercussions. And we also now have water pollution trading, and this is something that's started in the U.S., and I refer to a very important report that's been done by Food and Water Watch showing that water pollution trading is just a scam to allow factory farm operations or nuclear facilities or whatever to continue to dump their toxins into waterways and buy their way or trade their way or get around the law, basically, with this water trading. This has started in Ontario. It's the first province in Canada to start water trading, or water pollution trading. And then we have bottled water exports. We're fighting Nestle in Ontario. If the third well comes on stream, they'll be taking 6 million liters a day from the Grand River near Guelph, in a place called Elora, where there are 11,000 First Nations people who do not have access to running water. So this is just a travesty that a transnational multinational, transnational can come in, multi-billion dollar transnational can come in, take that water. In Ontario, it's $3.71. Here, as you know, it's $2.25 per million liters, and just bottle it and ship it around the world. So we've launched a boycott of Nestle. We've been monitoring wells as well, but 265 million liters a year. They have done for years, but of course it was just a free-for-all here until the new law came in last year. And so we really don't know how much water that the company has taken from Hope, but we know it's a great deal. And a great deal of it is on First Nations territory as well. And we're even seeing a return to the debate about commercial exports of our raw water. The Vancouver-based Fraser Institute, the Montreal-based Economic Institute, the Manitoba-based Frontier Centre for Public Policy, the University of Calgary School of Public Policy, former PM Jean Chrétien, former U.S. Ambassador Gary Doer, the CIBC's Jeff Rubin, and many others have recently, not years ago, recently started calling for Canada to open up the spigot to commercial exports again. And it's very important, if our government really does start to talk to the United States about renegotiating NAFTA, that we start to put it on the table, that water needs to be taken out. It's how I got involved in this issue in the very first place. Way back in the 1980s, I was reading the Canada-US Free Trade Agreement, and when I looked at the annex of what was considered to be a good, and it was not from that agreement, it was brought forward from the old GATT, the General Agreement on Trade and Tariffs, there was water as a tradable good in all its forms, including ice and snow. And I remember thinking, how could water be a tradable good? I don't understand how that could be. And that's what set me on this journey. Because in these trade agreements, it says you cannot limit trade in whatever has been defined as a tradable good. So we do have a weak law, I think it's still quite weak, that was brought in, surprisingly, by the Harper government.
Private
members bill, yes it was, thank you. But it's very unclear whether if one province decides to start commercially selling its water, if that legislation would be able to prevent that from happening. So I think you're going to hear more about this issue as the years go on, and our friends and neighbors to the south of us have more and more severe issues to deal with around their water. A man named Perry Karma is a best-selling author. He's an international relations expert. He's a CNN global contributor. And he just wrote a book called Connectography, Mapping the Future of Global Civilization. And he says that Americans should get to know the names of Canadian provinces because that's where their water is going to likely be coming from in the future. He says it's time to dust off the Grand and the Nawapa water export plans and take a page from Chinese and Dutch experiences using dikes and canals to move water. Arizona, Nevada, and California are running out of water, he says, and he reminds us, and I quote, without Canadian water, it is hard to imagine the United States continuing to produce one-third of the world's corn and feed the Colorado River. So for us to think that this is a debate in the past, I think it would be a mistake. And then in the book, I have a whole chapter on trade and how trade impacts our water. The threat started with the Canada-US Free Trade Agreement. It increased with NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement. We are now facing $2.6 billion worth of challenges, Chapter 11 challenges from American corporations around Canadian laws. Two-thirds of those are environmental. We now have signed for the third time, because Harper signed twice and the Trudeau government's just signed a third time, this agreement with Europe. But this agreement with Europe gives European corporations, a whole new set of corporations, the right to interfere in Canadian laws, Canadian rules, threatens us in terms of water privatization. The two biggest utilities in the world, Suez and Veolia, are French, totally behind these trade agreements, and if the municipalities that have gone private in Canada decide in 5 years they want to go back, they would not be able to do so. Written into the CETA is something called ratchet and standstill, which basically says once you've moved to public service to be privatized, to be commercialized, you can't move it back. So there are these trade agreements, and of course now we're whether the TPP or the Trans-Pacific Partnership is a new question, but these trade agreements are like a noose around the neck of good public policy, and it's something that we need to return to. We need to become trade literate again, as we have been in the past. So how is the Trudeau government doing so far in addressing these issues? Well, there's some good and some not so good. The good, I would start with their first budget. They actually put aside a very healthy amount of money for funding for First Nations for water and sanitation services. So this is a good sign. It was actually what the 70 First Nations and others were asking for. They did put some money back into fisheries and oceans, and did put some money back into Parks Canada, not much back into Environment Canada water programs. They started a consultation on what to do with the three gutted water acts, the Fisheries Act, the Navigable Waters Protection Act, the Canadian Environmental Assessment Act. They had promised that they would reinstate these laws. They're not doing that now. They're having these consultations, and Elizabeth and I share the analysis that this they should have just reinstated it if they wanted to improve. There was lots of place to do that in the future. And we're very nervous that the very industries that convinced them to gut these laws in the first place do not want them to be returned with any kind of strength. And so we're very afraid, pardon the pun, that they'll be terribly watered down. And it's extraordinarily important that people get involved in that. Let the government know, and I would say let your MP know, but you know your MP knows this, but let the Trudeau government know you're watching this, that you have expectations that these water laws will be returned. We absolutely need strong federal leadership to come up with a plan based on what I call a new water ethic. And the new water ethic basically has to say everything we do needs to ask the question, what's the impact on water? How we grow food, how we produce energy, how we trade across nations, we need to ask that question. Hassan Youssef, the head of the Canadian Labour Congress, he and I are on tour on this Trans-Pacific Partnership. He tells the story of asking a lead trade negotiator for the TPP, what was your mandate? What mandate were you given by the Harper government when you went out to join the or talk about the TPP? And he said, I had one mandate, and that was get a deal. Nothing about what to protect for Canada, how to look out for Canada's interests, nothing to do with our auto sector or Canadian jobs or Canadian environment or anything. Just go out and get a deal, period, full stop. That's the mentality. And I know that's the mentality because my next door neighbor is a senior official with the Trade Department. And he'll say over a beer on a summer evening, I'll say, who's looking after the issues about health care or human rights or worker protection or the environment or whatever? He says, I don't know. It's not my job. It is not in my mandate. It's not in the mandate of our department. It's just get an agreement. And then with each agreement, whatever you got in the last agreement will automatically be transferred. That's the new ceiling floor. If you didn't get what you wanted, you don't worry about it because you'll get it next agreement, and you just keep pushing the envelope so that CETA applies to subnational governments in a way that NAFTA did every day. And so with each new agreement, there are new threats to our public services and so on. So we absolutely need to put these issues together. Those of us concerned around the climate and water and the environment in general have to be integrated into the decisions and policy making of our government. And we need strong national drinking water standards. We need strong standards on wastewater. We need absolutely desperately strong standards on animal waste and nutrient overload into our lakes and rivers. We need strong national standards across the board on groundwater protection. We need to map our groundwater. We need this very badly, and we need a plan of action, and we need it sooner than later, because I feel this so strongly, that this notion that somehow we don't have the same issues that the rest of the world has are just not true. I'm just going to end the formal part of this and then open this up for discussion with just a short reading, because this is from the book. My very last words in the book, and I just wanted to share this with you. It's called Last Thoughts. Two decades ago, I asked Oscar Oliveira, the leader of the first water war, what it was about water that inspired the kind of courage he and others had displayed in standing up to the army in his country. At the direction of the World Bank, Cochabamba, Bolivia, allowed Bechtel to privatize and run its water services. The company tripled the price of water, making it too expensive for the majority of this largely indigenous, poor population. It even started fining people for capturing rainwater. The people wrote, that's true. They actually had inspectors who would go around community to community to see who was capturing rainwater. The people rose up against terrible odds. Many were hurt, some were killed, but they did not back down, and Bechtel was forced to abandon Bolivia. Oscar was a shoemaker by trade and had never done anything like this before. But his anger at the injustice of the situation gave him courage he didn't know he had. Why water, he said, knowing that I meant that there were many other terrible injustices his people, the Aymara, had endured over time. Because, he said, water is life. Local water is personal, mine, ours. How dare they claim it for their faraway investors? And because I would rather die of a bullet than of thirst. I remember this conversation a decade later when I went on my first tour of the Alberta tar sands. Accompanying our group were some activists from the Athabasca Chipewyan First Nation that lived downstream from the site. Among them was a young leader named Mike Mercury. At a press conference we held in Edmonton to describe what we saw and experienced on the tour, Mercury tried to explain what life was like for his people. Sometimes, he said, you just look around and you say, where did all of this come from? Some nights when you're out there in the bush or on the lake, when you look towards the south, you can actually see the lights glowing from industry, which tells us this is coming. It's coming. It's coming towards us. The trees are gone, they're being cut. The land is upside down and the water is being poisoned. It's like a moonscape out there. Mercury said that his people could no longer drink the water and were covered with sores and cysts when they swam in it. He said that people were dying, including members of his family. And this is what reminded me of Oscar. He then said, it would be kinder to come in and kill them with guns, than kill them quickly, than to do it this way. The water crisis is at our door here in Canada. All the issues we thought so far away are upon us now. A greater challenge has never faced the peoples of Canada. Each and every one of us has a personal responsibility to take action and collectively confront the kind of power structures that have prevented the kind of change needed to protect and honor the great water heritage of this land. Future generations have the same right to breathe clean air and drink clean water. Much rests on what we do now. Thank you.
Hi. I want to thank you to begin with for going up to Fort McMurray. I am embarrassed to say that I did work on the Syncrude site from 76 to 81 in the capacity of a laborer and a carpenter. And when I was a carpenter, I stood up high on the scaffolding 200 feet and I looked out, and what they called overburden was life. The trees, all the plants, the birds. Everything was gone. It was nothing but white sand. And I can remember thinking to myself, why aren't the protesters up here saying something about this? This was 1981. And then I realized, why aren't I saying something? And then it hit me. I'd be living in poverty again. But it was 2 weeks later that I quit. July 81, I couldn't take the devastation anymore. The money earned was not worth what I saw. So thank you so much for going up there and taking a tour and bringing it to light. But now I don't know if you mentioned anything about the run-of-the-river projects that they're promoting. And I lived in Powell River, and I saw the devastation that they were doing up there with the run-of-the-river projects. And last I heard, there was a moratorium on these projects. And I'm rather concerned about that, because the devastation was just as bad, if not worse, than what I saw in Fort McMurray.
Thank you very much. That was extremely interesting. We're fighting Site C here, which is the destruction of the Peace River. And I heard from some folks who were experts on it that they were not just concerned about the dam that we don't need. We don't need this power. It's going to cost us the earth, and it's going to double our hydro rates and might bankrupt hydro and then privatize it. But if we make a reservoir like that, that water is more available for export than if it's in the river, where it might have some protection, which it doesn't have much now that we've lost the Navigable Waters Protection Act. But I just wondered what your thoughts were on that. And to everyone in the room, if you don't know about Site C, please learn. We've got to save the Peace River.
Thank you so much for devoting your life to the betterment of our country. No, because earlier in my life I ran across Len Murray, and I just want to know what sort of leadership he's demonstrating in this whole Nestle's fiasco in Ontario, please.
You want to take one or two more?
One more, and then we'll.
Sure.
Yeah, I want to echo those thoughts. Thank you, and for being such an inspiration. It's funny. I was just saying the other day that it was the Free Trade Agreement in 1980 under Mulroney. That was sort of my political awakening. I was 10, and it was the water issue. My dad explained to me that if we started selling our water, we wouldn't be able to refuse that limit or that amount in the future, even if we were in severe drought. And I just thought that seemed absolutely insane. So I want to ask you, you talk about the need for a plan of action and about federal standards. I want to ask your thoughts. I actually think we need to go the opposite way. I think we need to put communities in charge of their water and in charge of protecting their water, and that we're going to have better outcomes in the long run if the people who are depending on the water are empowered to have the capacity and authority to protect it. So I'm just wondering your thoughts on that.
Wow, great questions, all of them. On, please don't be sorry that you worked there, and thank you for leaving that job and giving up. I think it's very important that we send a message to people who work in the tar sands, oil sands, and in other extractive industries. You're not the enemy. You know, we're if we had different kinds of if we had alternative, safer energy sources, that's where you would work. And we know that's not your first choice. And I've been there several times, of course, now. When I talk to people there, I meet people who say, I wouldn't bring my family here. So I'm afraid for the quality of life, the air and the water. I don't want to raise my kids here. But this is where I can get a job, and this is where, you know, this is my livelihood. So I think we need to have a real reach out to people in Alberta and say, as we convert, as we move to an alternative energy source, it's not going to happen right away. You're our friends, not our enemies. I think it's really important that we say that. On the run of the river, I'm not sure Elizabeth would know much more about the current status than I do. We were opposed to it, and I know the problems associated with it, but I'm not sure if there's a moratorium.
I don't know either. This picky husband, I don't know, but I fought it. We stopped it in Butte Inlet, but not in Toba. But at the moment, because of Site C, and the demand has been flat for energy, and BC Hydro has stopped buying, in fact, is paying people not to produce power at this moment. And so because we don't need the power from Site C, but then this is Christy Clark's great big dam. And so I'm not sure that there's much happening. We would support small run-of-river, very small, and you've seen it in First Nations
communities like Kapachisa by Port Alberni, but nothing larger, because I've seen the damage that it can do. So I'm not sure if there's been a stop to it at the moment, but there's no call for power. And I have been looking into it, but BC Hydro is really a closed shop and it's very hard to find out information. But I'll talk to some people and find out more.
Thank you, Vicki, very much. Now, next to your question on Site C Dam, I have heard the same concerns expressed about that water reservoir and generally where water is basically privatized, in essence. I mean, you could ask the same about any tailings pond, I guess, although who would want that water? But yeah, I just think we have to be very, very vigilant now. I don't know if you've, I'm sure all of you have been following what's happening in California. I mean, they're saying now it's not a drought. There's just a total geologic change. It's becoming a desert. That is the most water engineered place on Earth, with their canals and their pipelines and their shipping water from one place to another to grow, 80% of the world's almonds and eat up their water. It's a catastrophe. But it's not just in California. The Ogallala Aquifer, which is that aquifer that used to be the size of Lake Huron, that goes down the spine of the U.S. Midwest, is drying up. I mean, it wasn't until 1958 or 59 that they discovered this deep well, bore well technology that allowed them to pull this water up in this way. You've flown over where you see the great big circles. That's this deep circular bore well technology that allowed them to green the desert, but it's killing it. And the United States Department of Agriculture says that the Ogallala Aquifer will be dry in our lifetime. It will be gone in our lifetime. So you bet the United States is going to come calling for our water. And I'm doing a research on it for the book. I started to understand how that conversation is coming back a lot. It had died down. We fought it back. We batted it back when there was the proposal. Actually, the proposal was given the go-ahead by the Newfoundland government to take a lot of money out of a lake. Gisborne Lake in Newfoundland, and that was fought back partly because the Christian government convinced the government of Newfoundland that if they started doing that, NAFTA would allow those exports across the country. So, we need to be really vigilant and understand that on all trade agreements, this is very important for you to understand, all trade agreements say that water is untouchable in its natural form. But then in its natural state. But the moment it's not in its natural state, that it's in drinking water or bottled water, used for industry or used for agriculture, or any of the other things that we use water for, it has become a form of a commodity that can be then, and all the trade rules apply to this water as a commodity. Glenn Murray, who asked the question about Glenn Murray? Yeah, that's very interesting. Glenn Murray is the environment minister in Ontario. We're having this great big fight about this Nestle taking. And they put a moratorium on new water takings, although they're allowing Nestle to continue to take the water it's taking now. But they put a moratorium, and Glenn Murray was on radio not long ago talking about me, saying, well, I guess Maude Barlow is right when she says that there are trade concerns, and we're very concerned about the trade implications of stepping in and saying and denying Nestle or any private company access to this water. So here he was on national radio admitting that, yes, there may be rights that these corporations have. Now, Nestle is a European company, so it would have to, if it was going to use trade agreement to, to sue for damages, it would have to go through a subsidiary in the U.S., which it might not do. But it's another reason not to adopt CETA, because it would have the power.
And another reason not to support any of the bottled water companies.
No matter how much they pay. I mean, I think there are two questions here. How little we're charging for what's called raw water, and we need to have that conversation. Because when people say, well, the users have to pay for it, the municipal, residential, and small businesses take up about 9% of the water consumption. The rest of it is hydroelectricity, it's big agribusiness, it's big mining and so on. And we have to ask ourselves questions around who should have access to this water, no matter how much they pay. I don't think these bottled water companies should be having access to our water. And please join our boycott. Go to our website, canadians.org. join the boycott. We're close to 50,000 Canadians who pledged to boycott Nestle, and we want to reach 100,000. They're very nervous about it. NAFTA, the proportionality clause, was raised, and this is the same clause that applies to our energy, which is that we agree that we can't lower the amount of energy we're sending lower than the average of the last 3 years without proportionally cutting back to our own energy use. And the same would apply to water. If we start commercially selling our water to the U.S., the exact same provision would apply. This water has to come out of all of these trade agreements as an investment, as a good, and as a service. Just take it out. And the question, a really thoughtful question about local, absolutely, and I should have said that, and I'm very clear in my book that it's a partnership. But if that communities need to take care of water, the communities are best situated to know and protect their local water, but we have to be protected by strong national legislation. And that, because your communities are going to be left on their own, standing up to, you know, the big hydro companies or the big energy companies or the big bottled water companies without strong legislation. So we need the overall law. Martin Luther King said, legislation may not change the heart, but it will restrain the heartless, which is one of my favorite quotes. We need good law. This is this is our right. This is why we have a democracy. This is why we vote. We need good law. And we can't leave communities without any protection. So it's a real partnership that I envisage.
Any other questions?
I just wondered whether in your research you looked at all about the quality of rainwater, which is now to recharge the rivers and the groundwater, because it seems to me that, you know, with the amount of pollution, really, we're not improving the quality of the water once it's dead. It's only getting worse from the rainfall. Is that correct?
I have to say I didn't come across anything that said exactly that. What is clear from, and these are more recent studies, is that when you pollute groundwater, you're also polluting surface water, because of course it all interchanges. And so we think of it as staying down there, but the quality of rainwater by itself, I haven't seen any studies. What is very, very clear is that when you remove water or you remove vegetation from the local hydrologic cycle, you create warming, you create desertification. And in my humble opinion, I think we've left water out of the climate equation far too much. I think the way we treat water is a huge part of the problem. For instance, we all know about the drought, the devastation during the 1930s, in the prairies. And we know that what happened was that they cut down the grasslands very, very quickly. And so the topsoil dried up and blew away. Everybody knows that. They've known that for decades. What they also thought was that at the same time, coincidentally, there was a drought. No, it turns out now that they understand that the drought was caused by the fact that they cut down the prairie grassland. Then the local hydrologic cycle did not work properly. The rain doesn't come back if there isn't vegetation. Brazil, I mean, I think Brazil is one of the most important stories in the world. Brazil had no history of drought, none. And they are now in very serious trouble in the south. They have 120 million people in greater Sao Paulo living with a dying reservoir and no rain. Why? It's not climate change as we usually think of climate change. It's because they've cut down the Amazon. The Amazon rainforest gives off massive amounts of liquid, which is carried in these currents that they call flying rivers. And who knew, but flying rivers carry more water than all the rivers in the ground on the planet carry. And that's how that water would reach the south of Brazil. It's not happening anymore. When you interrupt the local hydrologic cycle, you interrupt the larger hydrologic cycle. And they're saying now that probably the drought in California and Texas is partly due to the taking down of the Amazon rainforest. So that's what's been clear in the more recent. I haven't seen quality of rain per se by itself since the days of acid rain, but that's a really important question.
I really appreciate the work that you and others have done and the Green Party in terms of outlining the problems and the concerns and the very short time that we have to do something about it. And I think I have a lot of confidence in the technology and the clever young people who will be able to solve quite a lot of these problems. But there's a fundamental underlying problem that I don't see or hear anybody really addressing, and I'd like your thoughts on it, is the population. If we didn't have the burgeoning population that's just going up like a rocket, it would make a big, big difference to greenhouse gas as well as the water and a lot of these things that are, you know, concerning so many of us. And I don't hear very much on population. And I'm curious to hear of anybody who's got thoughts and ideas on what how we might deal with that.
Thank you very much. 2 weeks ago, Sierra Club hosted a presentation up at UVic in collaboration with the UVic Caving Group. And they were talking about the karst systems, the limestone systems that underlie many of our, especially the old growth forests. And they were talking about how rivers, what rivers are protected still, will maybe protected, but as soon as they go underground, and many of them do go underground, there's no protection whatsoever. And there's extensive logging that's going on over these areas, and these sinkholes that are associated with these karst systems are being filled with timber. And the MLA, I think, from Alberni has been trying very hard to get a Caving Protection Act in, and you can't get it past second reading. So I don't know how many other karst systems there are throughout Canada where you'll have a river and then it disappears underground and there's no protection from mining or logging or any other contamination, and then it surfaces again, and that part of the river may or may not be recovered. So if you can comment more about, I guess, what we can do to sort of, I guess, understand how the surface water is connected to underground water, especially through karst systems.
Well, if you want to answer those, we'll take one more in the back of your head.
Okay. That sounds good. Oh, you want me to?
Yeah, go ahead.
No, just to say that thank you for that. I mean, absolutely. And that's why the lack of groundwater protection in Canada is so serious and why we need, again, so the people, local communities can do what they need to do. We need to have the law, and we absolutely need to demand this. We have no protections for our groundwater. It's shocking. And I will repeat a stat that I gave, that 87% of the chemicals sold and used in Canada have not been tested for toxicity. We're just dumping crap on our farms and in our waterways, and the mining tailings and the lack of discipline around logging, all of it. It's a free for all. And I guess the shocking thing, putting the whole thing together, and it's really quite devastating when you put the whole story together, is what the first thing I said tonight is that we're a people who think we love our water. It's in our mythology, it's in our music. If you were to ask Canadians what they love, it's our wilderness, it's our beautiful lakes and rivers, and yet we have not got this protection. So I think beyond asking the Trudeau government to reinstate these three gutted water laws, that's just a very, very beginning of what needs to happen. We need something far, far stronger. When they were in opposition, they had a water critic. They promised to have a water department or a water minister and, you know, a real collaboration with among all the departments that work on water. We need to go back to those promises and say this is terribly important. I think when you start to get the larger picture of what, where's Dave, what you said about 2030, it's just not enough time. One begins to understand that there's an urgency here. And I wanted to speak to the issue about population, because it's a very touchy one, as you probably know. Part of the problem is when we talk about population, we tend to think of places in the world that have a lot of people compared to perhaps Canada, but it's not so much density of population, but levels of consumption. So we in North America are the worst water wasters in the world. Australians are the second worst, and they have a water problem. Let me tell you, Europeans are the third worst. I remember being at a protest across in southern India, in Kerala state, across from a Nestle was it Nestle? It was a Coca-Cola, it was a Coca-Cola plant, which they've shut down, by the way, since then. They had a silent vigil. These women of all ages would get up every morning at dawn and sit across from that Coca-Cola plant and have a silent vigil for 3 years until finally it just kept getting more attention, national attention, international attention. But we had this big conference. We had it in the outdoors so we could use loudspeakers, so in the Coca-Cola plant they could hear everything we said, but all these politicians in. But I remember they fed us, and we were maybe 600-700 people, and we would have the food put on a leaf, a coconut leaf or whatever, and we would eat with chapatis or our hands, and then they would throw the leaves in the woods. We created less garbage, with those 600 people than I would with takeout in with my family, right? So I think the issue here is the way we live and the level of consumption. The more consumer-oriented we get, the more urban, the more sophisticated, the more up the chain we are, the more we abuse water, and the farther away we feel from it. And so I hear you on population. I do think that we need to ask the question, but it needs to be asked in relationship to consumption and our way of life. It's a tough one, yeah. One last, yeah.
Thank you, Maude, for your information. And I was going to say a cautionary tale, but it's rather more than that, I think. And there's almost a litany of countries that you can go through, and they're doing things so badly. So I'm wondering, is there a country that perhaps serves as a model of doing good with water?
Yes, I would say Germany is a model of that we to, you know, on the climate issue as well, on the energy issue, but on water, absolutely. I was just in Munich, and I remembered the first time I was in Munich was the first time I learned to like beer, because I never drank beer before, but their beer, because their water is so fabulous. They actually have a rule, because they get their water from the Alps, that everybody, all the farms, all the urban areas, all the industry along the way, has to be so careful that when that water comes out of the tap, it's clean enough for a baby to drink. And that's actually a law that they have there. They are so progressive. They're so passionate about their water. Same in Switzerland. I was in Zurich not long before that, and went swimming in, you know, in this beautiful lake that, I mean, it's right in the city. There's the city, and there's the lake, and people are swimming in it. Can you imagine that in Canada? I mean, a lake in the middle of a city. So yes, there are ways to do this. And in Europe, they also had an agreement in the year 2000 for watershed management. And this is where all of the, any lake, any body of water that crosses political boundaries must be shared, must be seen and governed in terms of its watershed, not as part of, you know, this country or this country. There are lots of problems in Europe, but they're doing it much, much better than we are. It's another reason we keep telling them not to sign this watershed agreement with Canada. Can I tell one story?
Yeah. Please do. Is it going to uplift us? We're looking for a cheer.
All right, a cheery story to end. Lovely, lovely place on Georgian Bay in Ontario, up in farmland called Simcoe County. And Simcoe County, maybe the city you might know is Barrie, that's the closest one, but it's the county council is made up of a bunch of mayors of small little municipalities, or little villages, and one of them is called Tiny Township, so we're talking small right here. And it's beautiful, it's right on Georgian Bay, it's a lot of tourists come there, it's prime, grade A farmland, it's just beautiful. There's an aquifer right on Georgian Bay called the Alliston Aquifer, and the Alliston Aquifer has been tested as having the clean, as among the cleanest water ever tested in the world. So what do you do with a beautiful aquifer on prime farmland right on Georgian Bay while you decide to build an industrial dump on it, right? Elizabeth knows the story well. So this was decided before they had the Clean Water Act in Ontario. So the local community fought it and fought it and fought it, and it wasn't just any old dump. It was to have four huge, what they call cells, all lined with plastic that's guaranteed for 2 years. But it was to bring in industrial waste from other municipalities, and they were going to pay Simcoe County to be able to use this. So it was going to take heavy industrial waste from everywhere. So the local community fought and fought and fought. And 5 years ago, we were out of fights, like we fought all the legal fights, and we were going to lose. So the heavy equipment started coming in. They confiscated the land. The land was being transformed to get ready to become this dump site. And there's a group of women in the Beausoleil First Nation said to the farm right across the way, could we set up a peace camp on your farm? And they said yes. So they set up a camp, and they lit a sacred fire, and they said the sacred fire will not go out until we stop this dump site, which was called Site 41. That's just the name of it. And thousands of people around the community had Stop Site 41 signs. It became an absolutely passionate fight. The women started getting up in the morning as the heavy equipment started coming in, 5 o'clock in the morning, and holding prayer vigils. Just happened to be in front of the heavy trucks, right, and they wouldn't be able to get in. So they stopped the process for that summer because it became too late and the frost was going to move in. And so the local warden was furious, and so he started arresting people. So he started taking away these young women, and he arrested an elderly farm couple. She was baking butter tarts for the local church bazaar when she got arrested. And she'd been a teacher, and she taught the kids who came to arrest her, these young police officers. They were just mortified. They said, we're really sorry, ma'am, and we have to arrest you. And she said, well, come in and have a butter tart first. And that gave us time to call the media, which, of course, was our thinking for doing it. So when she was led away in the paddy wagon, she said, if I'm going down, she'd never been arrested even for a parking ticket. And she said, if I'm going down, I'm going down for water. And I thought, we're going to win. That was the moment I thought we're going to win this fight. Anyway, one way and another, we got the county council to agree that August to a debate on the moratorium and a vote on holding a moratorium, because we had lined up some hydrologists to do finally some real studies, and we were pretty sure we could stop it. So it was a big deal, and when I tell you there were thousands of people coming out to this local county council right in the middle of nowhere, Midhurst or whatever, and we filled the balconies and had maybe another at least 1,000 people outside, and it was wild. I mean, people were throwing food from the balconies. It was democracy in the raw, and all the national media was there, CBC and CTV and The Globe and so on. So the council was met, broken up into basically three groups: those who were for the moratorium, they wanted to stop Site 41, those who were against the moratorium, and about a third in the middle, and we had no idea who was going to win, right? So the woman who was on our side, leading the challenge, the councillor from Tiny Township, Peggy Brackenridge, got up and she gave a passionate speech on why we needed the moratorium. She sat down. Then this guy got up, and he was a retired businessman, a former linebacker, big tough guy. Used to love fighting the protesters. He would do this to the protesters. He was the biggest fan of Site 41, had been fighting for it from day one. Gets up to speak, and we thought, if he's good, he's going to swing that third, and we're going to lose. So you could hear a pin drop, right? He starts to cry. This is true. And he catches his voice, and he said, when I went into my home office this morning, I was getting all ready to come in and fight you guys. He went like this. But he said, my grandchildren had found one of the Stop Site 41 signs, and they'd written the word Papa on it, meaning Stop Site 41, Papa, you. And he said, in that moment, my job description changed, and I became a steward of the water of Simcoe County. And he said, as long as I live, Site 41 will never happen, it will never take place. And it didn't. The decision was revoked, the license was revoked, the land's gone back to being farmland, and this guy's become the chief steward of the water of Simcoe County. So if it can happen to this guy, it can happen to this guy.